Okay, good morning, campers. My name is Claude.
I'm Ethan.
And today we're going to do the Grandfather Mountain Trail from the Profile Trail all the way up to the Swinging Bridge, and we're going to camp on top at Raven's Ridge?
I have no idea.
I guess we'll find out. Yeah, I guess we'll find out.
But before we get started, as we're driving here, let's take a quick look at what we're going to be doing. What we're going to do, and what we recommend for everyone to do, is to take the Profile Trail up to Grandfather Mountain Trail. Then, make a right, and head to the bridge. We're going to check that out, and then come back to the campground. You can choose anyone between Attic Window and High Balsam Shelter. This will put you between 10 to 15 miles in total for your entire trip. 5 miles to get to the bridge from the beginning. 1 to 3 miles to get back to your campground of choice. And another 3 to 5 miles to climb back down the next day. Grandfather Mountain is a beautiful hike and a fun challenge for any backpacking trip. So in order to make it a successful one, there are some things we should know. Please note that these trails and hikes are strenuous and not your run-of-the-mill hikes. All over the maps, it says that they are strenuous and hard hikes, so keep that in mind. Something that you need to know if you are day hiking is to bring water and a filter, maybe around 3 water bottles. I ran into many day hikers that underestimated the amount of water that they needed on trail, and I even had to give away some of my own. There are 2 water sources to plan on in your trip. One is at Shanty Springs, along the Profile Trail, and the other is at a water fountain inside the gift shop at the bridge. Shanty Springs is well marked and provides water from the mountain before you get to the Grandfather Trail. It's a great stop to relax and hang out at, with a massive rock face as entertainment. The water is allegedly as natural and clean as it gets, as I spoke to a rescuer, more on that later, and others that said they just drink it straight up. I filtered it just to be safe anyway, though. The water fountain at the bridge gift shop is free to access and near the bathrooms, but is only open until 5 p.m., so if you're trekking there, I recommend you get there before it closes. If you intend to camp, you need to go online and purchase a permit for the night. As much as I'm not a fan of having to buy permits, mainly because I already dropped a grand on all of my camping equipment, it helps prevent overcrowding and can help in search and rescue efforts. The reason you're starting from the Profile Trail is because the parking lot at the beginning is free to stay in overnight, assuming you have a camping permit. Additionally, you can't park overnight at the Swinging Bridge parking lot. If you park at the Swinging Bridge and your car is still there after 5 p.m., they will assume that you're a hiker and will come searching for you. Before we get going, keep in mind that many of the campsites, as it shows on the map, do not allow you to have campfires due to how windy you could get and for the potential for brush to catch. Remember that bears also do exist, and although you may not run into one, minimize your chances by carrying a bear vault or suspending your food in a bag in the air. When you first arrive to the Profile Trail parking lot, before you get started, make sure to get one of the permits and sign any relevant information. Make sure to grab a map too. As we get started, along the first 1.5 miles, you'll notice it's kind of like a warm-up. There's some up and down, some nice views, and some of what you'll see along the first bit of this trail is characteristic of what you're going to see on the rest of it, like the rock stairs and amazing outcrops. This first bit mostly parallels Highway 105. You'll hear it, but likely not see it. After you finish that first bit, you'll get to a sign that divides the lower Profile loop trail and the trail that takes you up the rest of the mountain. You can expect from here on out to go pretty much up. The incline is comparable to Mount Mitchell, at about 500 or 600 feet of incline per mile. Toward the finish of the Profile Trail, you might wonder when the endless rock stairs, well, stop. You'll reach what feels like a flat spot at the ridge and go down for just a second, and then you'll come to the intersection of the Profile Trail and the Grandfather Trail. This is where you'd make your right to head towards McRae's Peak and Swinging Bridge. Don't worry, we'll come back to Callaway Peak. At this point, the Grandfather Trail you're on becomes super technical and dangerous. You're climbing up and down steep rock faces, so make sure you're well equipped with boots that have great grip. I probably would have cried and slipped everywhere if I had my usual sneakers on. However, the trail is super beautiful and you'll see so many great overlooks. After 2 more miles of crazy ups and downs, ladders and ropes, we finally ended up at the swinging bridge. Don't worry, I'll show you some of those ladders in just a second. We crossed the swinging bridge, also famous for being exactly 1 mile above sea level, and ended up cooking some food. Some folks thought it was quite curious all that we were doing, and wondered our plans for the rest of the day, so we obliged. We hung around for a little while, but it was getting kinda late, so we packed up and started heading back. My phone was dead on the way to the bridge, and it was charging while we were there. So on the way back is when we got all the really cool footage of all those ladders, shuffling between crevices, and more. We backtracked to McRae's Peak, and got a really great panoramic view when no one else was around. Highly recommend stopping here. We continued along, and we finally got back to the Profile and Grandfather Trail intersection. We decided to go back down Shoshani Spring for just a second just to fill up one more time before we headed to our campsite. As it would turn out, we had learned of someone who sustained a knee injury on trail, and they had to be wheeled down with this peculiar mountain rescue gurney. We ran into this party on the way down to the water source, and got to speak with some of the rescuers. Out of respect, I didn't film any footage of the rescue, but remember to know your limits and try not to do anything dangerous on trail. Otherwise, rescuers will come and put themselves in harm's way to rescue you. We got to the water source, filled up on water, and headed back up to the intersection. At the intersection, we turned left, headed towards Callaway Peak, went, kept going, summited Callaway, and then some, and for some reason we couldn't find our campsite. It doesn't help that the internet doesn't have any pictures or videos of it, and the map seemed deceiving, because it should be right there next to the peak. But we kept going, and we actually did eventually find it. We set up camp, but we also noticed that sunset was coming, so we rushed up to the top, and we got to watch a beautiful sunset while drinking some hot chocolate. A surreal way to end the day, if you ask me. A little while after that, it started to get chilly, so we went back down and called it a night. The next morning, we broke camp, drank some more hot chocolate, saw Callaway Peak just one more time, and set back down the mountain. Oh, and don't forget while you're going up and down Profile Trail to check out the Profile of Grandfather. That's why it's called the Profile Trail, and why it's also called Grandfather's Mountain, is because of this rock face. Some people will say that it's the nose and the eyes and the chin when you look at the ridge from afar, but it's actually this rock face. Almost forgot to include that one. Anyways, I hope this is plenty enough for you to get an idea of what backpacking Grandfather Mountain looks like. While it's somewhat difficult, it's also super rewarding at every turn. I hope you have a blessed day, and that you also go into God's creation and experience His beauty.